I'm very pleased that the Tree of Life painting is going to the Alma Foundation in Mexico City. Mexico City is one of my favorite places in the world, as many people would agree. It's one of the places that one feels full of vibrancy and energy. It's a fabulous place. I'm very pleased to have the painting there. It'll be seen. The series, the Tree of Life series, has been going on, has engaged me now for a couple of years. It's a very simple but very effective compositional idea about juxtaposition, in which this central core of a tree image that bisects the painting and vertically creates two halves, which are then populated by male and female characters, and usually in some kind of oppositional attitude. As simple as that is, it just seems to have a magical generator of possibilities and pictorial energy. In this painting in particular, the oppositional figures are the two girls on the left side and the middle-aged guy at the beach on the right side. And narratively speaking, the painting raises the question of what do these characters know about each other? Do they even know they're in the same painting together? The girls seem to be aware of the guy on the other side of the tree, but the guy doesn't seem to be aware of anything except a handful of sand that he's holding. I just think it's funny to make a painting in which the characters in the painting either do or do not have an awareness of being in the painting with other characters. But of course, they're just characters. They're just things that we draw. They're not people. I like also the fact that the tree is a fanciful, not a literal tree, but a tree that has this exaggerated, graceful, lateral movement to the trunk. And it produces a handful of leaves that are colored in different ways to partially obscure what's going on in one of the halves of the frame. Sometimes even the characters' faces get obscured by the leaves. And the painting, in a way, is saying that there's nothing which is not painting. The fact that leaves can be obscuring faces, in a way, establishes the primacy of the painting as opposed to the primacy of the cartoon. The cartoon is at the service of the painting, as it were. It's with any painting, the real juice of it is in the compositional energy, the things that, if you look at the painting and talk to someone about it, you say, well, it's these characters, these girls, and this guy, and the tree. Which is true, but what makes it compelling to look at is the internal rhythms that are embedded in those figures and the way that they're positioned, the way they're deployed relative to each other and to the edges of the canvas, just as if it were an abstract painting, actually. The characters in the painting are derived from the work of a man named Peter Arno, who was a cartoonist associated with the New Yorker magazine. From its earliest days, I think he might have been the first hire of the magazine in 1927 or 1929. And he worked for the New Yorker, making very sophisticated cartoons until the early 60s, really. I think he died in the mid 60s. So it was a very, very long period, what we come to think of as a mid-century style, a very long period in which Arno defined urban New York centric sophistication. I don't know if it still exists or not, but the images are still wonderful. So my use of the images is both, I would say, appropriation and not. It's also an homage to not just Peter Arno, but the whole image world of the New Yorker magazine. The Tree of Life as an idea is a very ancient idea. It shows up in paintings from very early medieval or even Byzantine times. It's an image from the Bible, the tree of life is usually shown with Adam on one side and Eve on the other, and the fall from grace in the Garden of Eden is sort of one of the oldest themes in literature. Somehow juxtaposing the an image of biblical literary resonance, embedding these mid-century Arno characters in the midst of this kind of biblical image, just struck me as very funny and something that I hadn't seen before, so it gave me a lot of room to play around in.